got ready to do another video, had a severe coughing attack. And so this is really something. Maybe it's time for a history lesson. The main emphasis of these videos is what we're doing is we're transferring allegiance away from falsity to truth. And there's a lot of resistance involved in this. Because the falsity doesn't want to let go. Here, for example, history lesson. most people don't really know the history of this planet, of human civilization. Of course, I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. The human body and human civilization has absolutely nothing to do with what I am. It has nothing to do with what anyone is. Nothing to do whatsoever. And it's good to keep reminding ourselves of this, that the same way some bizarre dream has nothing really to do with the dreamer. I hope I don't start coughing, but it's trying to. Wow. Now, humans, what we call humans, started out with a DNA manipulation for the purpose of slaves. Purpose of slaves. Human race started out as a slave race for extraterrestrials, actually. South Africa, parts of Africa, they're huge areas of human habitation in civilization around what? Gold mines. It was all about mining gold. Originally, it was men, males, that were manipulated from hominoids to make human slaves. Then, when they decided they wanted more slaves, they manipulated DNA, genetics, and produced a female human so that they could reproduce more slaves for them. So they would have to go through the gene manipulation. This was easier for them. This brought a problem. Too many humans started popping up. And what happened was the extraterrestrials, Anunnaki, some say, but those who came from the heavens, reptilian race, they basically started working on a hybrid program, a mixture. What they took is they took the female humans and they had male extraterrestrial reptilian males. They produced offspring, and this hybrid offspring is what we call aristocracy throughout history, the monarchs, the rulers, and they used these hybrid offspring to rule. So they kept this bloodline. They produced a bloodline with a lot of reptilian extraterrestrial DNA and genetics, etc. Now this aristocracy, the ascendant genetic characteristics were reptilian, and so they shared the belief of the reptilian extraterrestrials that humans were created as slaves and belonged to the reptilians. They belonged to them as property. And this continues to this day, actually. This mindset, you wonder, why is this mindset in the world of enslavement and property? It comes from this. That the reptilians believe that they own us, that they made us human bodies. Of course, I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Bodies and civilization has absolutely nothing to do with what I am. So, this is at the root of a great. We can't just, you know, sweep this under the rug. At least be a little bit aware of a real history of this planet. Now, the human women saw the incredible advantages there were to being chosen by a reptilian male. They were elevated into, like, you know, godlike status, with sumptuous palaces and slaves and everything, you know. So the women saw this and they said, wow, this is our road, you know, out of slavery. And so they became very, very focused on trying to attract the attention of reptilian extraterrestrials as mates, as wives. This is where makeup came in. You see women today, they're still making up like baboons. Why? That attracts reptilian DNA, genetics, all this, you know, the black, if they, you know, they put the black around the eyes, and then the turquoise and the eyes, blue eye, you know, eye eyeliner, then eyeshadow, and red here. They do all this makeup. Well, they learn the arts of makeup to attract the reptilians, extraterrestrials. And they became very focused on vanity. They wanted more beautiful clothes, more beautiful this, more, because of, you know, that's their ticket. They saw this is our way that we can be happy. And they became very, very competitive with one another, very clever, and very focused on trying to seduce, become seductresses of these ETs. And the ones who were able to snare an ET, of course, they felt that they were infinitely superior than all their other sisters and brothers. And they made sure that they were, you know, worshipped. That they were somehow intrinsically superior, not being willing to admit that it was because of all the clever seduction that they were able to pull off. They felt that they were somehow intrinsically superior. And so there has been this very strong aristocratic component throughout history. I call it the princess syndrome. The princess syndrome is this has been a very strong dynamic of history, actually. Very strong dynamic. Whereas human males prefer, actually, just a basic, down-to-earth, good-hearted, sincere, honest woman, okay? Not all the makeup, not all the fancy hair, not all the fancy clothes, anything like this, no. But there's another twist to it, is the hybrid aristocracy needed lots of slaves, and needed overseers, and needed human participation in their vast estates, their vast lands, their vast empires. And so, the overall cleverness, partly the cleverness of the women wanting to have better situation. Hey, look, hey, if you work for them, you know, we'll have a better dwelling place, better everything. Come on, and let's do that. And they may try to attract the ETs' interest. Hey, look how beautiful I am, and maybe my family can come work for you. And this is kind of how it worked. And you get into the employ of the aristocracy, producing music, producing fine clothes, and building projects, finances, lots of different administrative, bureaucratic, entertainment of all types, and then you would get into that whole scene of the aristocracy, the hybrid aristocracy, and of course many of us have been in that scene. Many tried, of course, to realizing, hey, I'm going to get paid a lot more. I'm going to have a better life if I can make some music that they like. Then, you know, I'll be welcome in court, and I'll be able to get some money. They'll support me. So throughout history, the aristocracy has, they've had all the money. They support the various things that they like. So, but keep in mind, always, that they view humans as their property, as slaves. And they think nothing of manipulating and lying and doing whatever they need to do, the same way we would do something to cattle, for instance. They think of us pretty much the same way we think of sheep, cattle, and goats, and livestock, you know, basically. Dogs, you know, intelligent enough to do stuff, but certainly not deserving of any genuine consideration whatsoever. So if they want something, they'll promise you whatever it takes, and tell you, yeah, sure, we'll help you out. And if you do this, you'll be part of us. You'll rise up in status and all this kind of stuff. They get as much out of you as they possibly can, and then discard you in a garbage dump without a second thought about it. In fact, to have pity and mercy, compassion on the slaves is deemed to be an atrocious, not worthy of them. You know, so this is how human history has really developed. It's a very vicious, terrible story, actually. And I've experienced this directly myself, being totally misled and lied to and deceived, because I was used to the aristocracy, serving aristocracy through music. This is where the market was in Europe. So if you could produce music, they would say, "Ah, this is so lovely. This is, I like this. Who are you? Why don't you come work for us?" You know, like that. And we'll promote your music. Yeah, so you get around this aristocracy of the big money, the big power, the big control, and you try to entertain them to make a living. And you get corrupted, because their ways are very corrupt. I mean, the reptilian ways are very different than human ways. We would see it seen as being very corrupt and very nasty. And the hybrids are worse. Many can be even worse, because they have some sort of insecurity. Like they think, well, we're not really, you know, good enough to quite be, you know, with the ETs. So we got to impress them to make sure that they're, you know, that we don't show any human failings, so to speak, right? Human failings. So they can be even worse. Very arrogant and haughty, and of course, history is full of these aristocrats behaving in extremely nasty ways. Princess syndrome, absolutely. The queen saying, "Hey, king, you know, people are disrespecting me. I feel disrespected. How can I, you know," this is her insecurity coming out. See, the women that married the ETs had a lot of insecurity. Humans had a lot of insecurity. They never felt equal. So nothing was ever good enough for them. They wanted more. Get me more, you know. They need to deal with this insecurity. A really very nasty situation. And so this princess syndrome, you never can do enough for them. They nothing is too good for them. They have to have more. So they want you, they think that your purpose in life is to get them more and to free them from their insecurities. Well, their insecurities are largely based because they're trying to elevate themselves to the status of the ETs. Okay, and they're caught up in this materialistic, delusional dream of time-space process form. They don't have spirituality. They have this greed, ambition, vanity driving them. This is basically what drives civilization, has driven the world. And then into that comes religious teachings. They say, you know, by the way, the so-called God that most of the world worships, are they really the ETs, the rulers, the ET rulers? That's why they're so vicious, you know. We're in church last Sunday, and the first reading was that Nineveh, which is an Assyrian capital, Assyrians, kind of like North Syrian area right now, where a lot of the conflict is taking place, actually. Close to Turkey, southeastern Turkey, and north Syria, Nineveh. They said it's such a huge city that it takes you 3 days to travel through it. I mean, there was immense cities back in those times. Okay, the ancient cities. And there's some prophet who said, "Hey, people of Nineveh, you're not acting the way that God wants you to act. And if you don't stop acting that way, God's going to come down and kill all of you." And so the people got so frightened that they changed their ways and said, okay, we'll stop acting in a certain way and we'll act in this way. And then the prophet says, "Oh, okay, God is so pleased by your repentance, changing of actions, customs, whatever, that God has decided not to kill you all and spare you all." And I say, "Oh, God is so great, God is so good." This comes from the fact that the ETs did destroy a great many humans. In fact, the flood, the deluge, was apparently something that they managed to do, because the humans were becoming too clever and were trying to build their own space forts, and they do a lot of stuff. We're trying to get into DNA. I mean, the reptilian aliens are heavily into DNA manipulation and genetics. This is what the Garden of Eden allegory, part of what it's talking about, is: don't touch the fruit in the middle of the garden, meaning the DNA, the genetics. And what happened was it got out of control, and there were all sorts of mixing of genetics between different animals. And so you would have all these cross mixes between different breeds of animals. It was just absolute night and crazy back then. We're actually already back to that now. That was the days of Noah. And in the days of Noah, the wickedness was so rampant on this world of humans and the human hybrids. It was just astonishing wickedness. They decided to trigger a massive deluge, a massive tidal wave, and wipe out humans, as many humans as possible, which they did. And throughout history, when humans really got unruly, they would come in and they would destroy them, the ETs. So, and they said, "We're doing this on the orders of the ruler, the god of this world." So humans, civilization grew up fearing the god of this world, which is an ET, one of the ruler of the ETs, ruler of Anunnaki, probably. And they, of course, greatly feared this god. And they said, "Oh my god, if we don't do what we're supposed to do." Another cough's trying to come up. This god's going to give orders to wipe us out. So, all these animal sacrifices, there actually was human sacrifice for a long time, animal sacrifices, burnt offerings, pleasing to these reptilian ETs, that was all to the extraterrestrials. And so, along came Jesus, and there were other teachers. Buddha, for instance, also came along, and they taught us truly. They said, "Hey, no. I bring a New Testament, for instance, Jesus' New Testament, not the Old Testament." Now, I serve a God of love, of forgiveness, of compassion, of mercy, of love. And Jesus continues to tell us that the idea that God would try to destroy what God created, what God absolutely loves, is completely ridiculous. There's not a grain of truth to any of that. The belief that if you don't behave, humility, truth, honesty, be self-effacing, be prayerful, practice what Jesus told us to practice. You know, stay, very modest, unassuming. Don't curry favor with the ETs. They think, hey, that you're holding me back. You're holding me back. That's evil patriarchy there. You know, you're holding us back. That's what we've been told. So we have a whole world society now demonizing human males who dare warn and still talk out about, hey, what's really going on? So, until the use of advertising, the women's body in advertising is just a horrible world evil, actually. And human men just hate it. I mean, I like I said, if I never see another glamorous woman's body ever, it'll be too soon. It'll be way too soon. If I never see it ever again, it'll be way too soon. It is just sickening. It's absolutely sickening. And of course they say, oh, you're trying to oppress us, you're not letting us express ourselves. No, they're running around like hookers desperately trying to hook one of them. They know that the hybrid ETs are coming in this world, and they're desperately trying to curry favor with this new aristocracy, with the new old aristocracy. There are hybrid races coming on this planet, actually. Those will be the rulers of this planet. No change, actually. No big change. They've been continually refining what they've been doing. And so, it's just like, it's sickening. It is absolutely sickening. And then, of course, the human males who can't stand this, they're portrayed as the bad ones now. They're terrible ones. They're standing in the way of progress. They're standing in the way of the fullness of feminine expression and their self-esteem and their self-empowerment, blah, 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 blah. No, they're basically, following their vanity is what they're doing. And of course, be careful what direction you go in, because that's what you're going to get. It's just like, wow. Enough is enough is enough is enough. I mean, but it's not going to change here, is it? It's just unbelievable. You go into any grocery store, any drugstore, big, posters of these super glamorous women with makeup and selling everything under the sun, make the profits bigger for the big corporations. Buy all the stuff, and meanwhile I get all this money for fronting you, selling this to you, and making you think that you're just a human slave. Look at this. This is what's supposed to make you happy. Sensuality, materiality, all that feeds our belief that we're bodies, which means that we believe we can't be free, and we have to live our whole lives as slaves of the powers that be here in the world. So it's a terrible cycle. All religions insist on great modesty in the religion, especially on the part of women, that they must cast vanity aside and not try to curry favor with the aristocracy. It's very important. Very, very important. And of course, this is all jeered at now. Like, jeered. Well, those who are doing the jeering, they're just showing how ridiculous they are, actually. Because those who know the truth about the situation know very well what they're up to. And we're not fooled. Not fooled at all. And so you have this mad power grab in this world now. From everywhere, any maiden throughout the whole planet now feels like, hey, you know what, I got a shot at it too. I think I can leap into the hierarchy of this planet. If I just look enticing enough and just somehow hook one of the higher-ups, I got a shot. And then, of course, there's a whole industry involved now, massive industry in selling all these, catering to the vanity of the women of the world, of saying, hey, yeah, we'll get you all dressed up, all dolled up, and we're the one. If you come to us, we're the ones who can. If you wear these clothes, you're the one. You're gonna succeed. You're gonna be the lucky one. This is a massive, massive industry on the planet of glamorizing females and catering to their desperate desire, you know, to get lucky. And if they would come over to Jesus Camp and spend the same amount of time and effort, they would realize, wow, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And they would be extraordinarily wise. Right? That's the tragedy of the situation. But our economy now is so hooked into this. Yes, look how great I can dance. Look how great I can sing. Look how glamorous I can look. Look. And what they're doing is their behavior and their body language and the way they act, it's all designed to entice extraterrestrial reptilians. Totally. You know, and human males just use these words to refer to them, you know, which they get very angry with. Very angry if we use those words. But those words are very appropriate, actually. That kind of behavior is just despicable to human males. Absolutely despicable. And they don't care because they're trying to hook these reptilians, actually. So, I mean, their job is hookers, really. And their body language, the way they act, the way they express, you know, the reptilians love very scantily, you know, the maidens be very scantily clad and showing off their body and all this. So they go out in public like this. I wonder, what planet am I living on? I must be living on a reptilian planet here. I just can't believe the way women dress. You know, it's just like, You must have no respect for human males whatsoever, is what I'm saying. I want to say that you have zero respect for human males. And no respect for yourself either. So they're caught up in the vanity of the times. As Tom Wolfe said, bonfire of the vanities is the time we live in. It's a bonfire of the vanities, absolutely. And men are just like, wow. We're on the sidelines, like, wow, we can't say anything. If you say anything, they'll come down on you. Like an avalanche, basically, yeah. Lose your job, lose your friends, lose everything. If you dare speak up against this situation, right? Say, hey. It's madness. It's absolute madness. And again, the voices have dwindled almost to nothing at this point. Almost virtually nothing. That's why I try to speak up. My voice is severely tacked and I can hardly even talk. That's how severe it is. I mean, you look at these magazines, the way the women look, you say, who are they trying to attract? It can't be any human male at all. It's obvious. What, again, human male? Very plain. Not going to try and make the man slave away for their vanity at all. A woman doesn't have vanity. And so the human male says, wow, there's a good friend, companion. Sometimes they will be still, they will be quiet, they will be prayerful. Doesn't want to read all those fashion magazines, all this kind of stuff. That's what human males say. Yeah, that's great. That's helpful. Let's keep deepening our prayer. Let's follow Jesus even more, right? So it's a prayer for help. Prayerful household, whatever your religion happens to be, where you spend a lot of time in meditation, a lot of time in prayer. That's the kind of woman that human males really respect, you see. One who truly respects themselves is not whoring after reptilians. So television, the whole world economy in many ways, the entertainment industry, the movie industry, the television industry, the advertising industry, the cosmetics, the fashion, goes on and on and on and on, products. You know, the car commercials, you see these women who, you say, who are they trying to please? And you got this really like weird looking men with them that are like, you know, hybrids, kind of trying to look like hybrids actually. And most of the men in commercials have this human hybrid look, ET human hybrid look, and the women are these sleazy, glamorous, you know, hookers who are trying to, you know, say, hey, look what this car will get you, you see, you know. And it's just like, you say, what does this have to do with me? Absolutely nothing. It just is like, what's going on here in this world? Well, I'm telling you what's going on. We do live on a basic reptilian hybrid, alien hybrid world to a large extent. That is what is coming. And this is the women, ever very sharp. They know, you know, where is the opportunity for us to, you know, improve our vanity, our comfort zone, etc. And they've been all over this for quite some time. The whole glamour thing, the big sunglasses, you know, they're trying to mimic what they're trying to figure out what is it that the ETs, what turns them on? This is what they're very, very been frantically studying now for such a long time. And human males are just saying, like, they lost interest in us. What's going on? I don't know, this is bizarre what's happened. Well, I'm telling you what has happened. They knew, they figured out that their opportunity to hook up with ETs and hybrids and get involved and be part of a hierarchy, aristocracy, a larger aristocracy on this planet. They recognize their opportunity. And so their interest was on studying what turns these people on. Okay, how can I seduce them? Forget about the human males, they're not even interested in them anymore. Not even interested in them. Here come the beetles, you know. Here come the hybrids, here come the hybrids, here come the ET human hybrids. Here come the extraterrestrials, here. How do we, you know, get in bed with them? Because we're gonna have luxuries. We're gonna have better luxuries. We'll be protected. Well, you know, all this kind of stuff. Our children and grandchildren will be, you know, journey to the stars. We'll be superior, that kind of stuff. So they have become obsessed with that. We are absolutely obsessed with it over the last 50 years or more. You know, started in the 50s, so it's been 64 years or so, if you give the 50s. It really started, it's actually been late 40s it actually started, after World War II is when it really got going. So it's been, what you could say, it's been 66 years. There's 66, number 66. Where the ETs, you know, started unfolding their blueprint here, what they're going to do. And the women caught hold of that, whiff of it, and, you know, wow. They said, this is our future. This is our future. And so men are just basically slaves here, you know, and don't have any respect at all anymore, for the most part. Almost none. The male voice has no more authority in this, on this planet. It's been marketed, demonized, marginalized, demonized as only designed to hold women back. Yeah, designed to holding them back from disaster. This is what it's designed for. You know, but the time has run out basically for that. I mean, we did the best we could. But, you know, when a woman's pursuing this vanity, you know, they won't listen to anyone, basically. You know, they'll turn a deaf ear to the warnings. Because they can be, you know, blinded by shiny things like, I'm going to have diamonds and jewels and these glittering gowns, and I'm going to look like a goddess. In fact, I will be a goddess, and people will worship me, and I will have retainers, and I will have, you know, it just goes on and 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 on. It's like, wow. And they just turn a deaf ear to those who are in positions of authority to warn and say, don't go down that path. That's ruinous for you, and it's ruinous for society in general. Well, listen. So, male authority is gone, basically, on this planet, to a large extent. It's gone. even in the traditional societies that, you know, the male did have authority to say, hey, you know, cool it on the vanity here. Let's be very careful on this. We know we're not supposed to do that. That's basically, it's just symbolic now. And the woman's going to do whatever she wants to do at this point. And they call that liberation. Liberation. They're, you know, liberation, like I'm liberated to be as stupid as possible. Liberated for fault, to be folly, to pursue folly. What kind of liberation is that? I mean, I'm liberated, I don't have to have any discipline anymore. I can pursue where my vanity takes me. That's the liberation. I can pursue wherever my vanity takes me. Well, it's going to take you into some very, very, very nasty situations for sure. It's like those rich ladies now who have had too many procedures on their face, and their lips are puffed out like pufferfish, and they look like some bizarre creature from the Black Lagoon or something, you know. That's to take a look where vanity takes you. Every kind of cosmetic surgery. You know, there's a whole industry of cosmetic surgery, right? Women are gobbling up so much in healthcare because they're desperate to augment themselves in every possible way. I mean, really? Human males, is that what they want? Heck no, actually. And there's a saying, if you want to be happy the rest of your life, make sure you marry an ugly, get an ugly woman for your wife, meaning one that's not obsessed with vanity. Absolutely. Vanity will lead you astray, badly. And so, you know, the men are tired of warning the women about this. Warning them, we're absolutely worn out and sick and tired of it, you know. And then they've stopped listening anyway. So what's the point? What's the point at this point? What's the point? Just drop, you know, drop all thinking, all thoughts altogether. And now, Jesus has not exactly made clear, you know, what are our options? Is this something that is what we're supposed to practice? Yeah. But we realize, I am spirit, I am free, I'm not a body, I am free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Jesus says the world will be beautiful and wonderful and everything like that. Well, I hope so, but that doesn't, what does that do with massive vanity, glamour, hideous problem here where males are seem to have no voice at all? You know, a lot of the spiritual teachers are viewed by women as like part of the hierarchy, you know, of the ET hierarchy, and they swarm around them like flies trying to figure out how to seduce these teachers, you know, how to please them, how to seduce, how can I be, you know, be on the inner circle, you know. They're always trying to get on the inner circle and figure out, and you listen to them, they're not really asking questions about enlightenment. They've learned the game, like, oh yeah, I'm supposed to say this, and I'm supposed to say this, I'm supposed to say, yeah, I feel this way, and I feel this way. But so they're all acting. They're acting. Most of them are just actresses. They're very clever actresses, women, actually. And they can be. That's part of the thing. Putting on an act, like, oh, you reptilian god, you're completely, incredibly ravishing to me, you're unbelievable, you know, you just, no one's ever looked more powerful and mighty, and, you know, they're able to put on this act, like they're overwhelmed by the wonder of this reptilian, these hybrids or whatever, they're just beyond belief. It's all an act. They're putting on act, very good at that. And so they're acting like to these spiritual teachers, like, oh wow, you're like amazing, you're so incredible, yeah. And okay, I'm supposed to say this, okay, yeah. Okay, I'll say this. And some of the spiritual teachers say, you're just trying to please me, right? And they go, ah, and they go silent. And it's like, whoa, I've been found out, you know. it's because they're basically kind of rehearsing with these spiritual teachers, like, how am I going to get into the higher divine, you know, hierarchy. I want to be a consort of the, you know, the higher-ups. I want to be a consort. Of course they want to. That's what they think. Keep in mind, Jesus says, even the newbies in my way are greater than the greatest. Who are not, you know, who are still pursuing delusion. He says that those in the kingdom of heaven, even the newbies in the kingdom of heaven, are greater than the greatest who are not the very greatest are not. This is true. This is true. So, this is what's been going on. This is what I've been observing. That's what we belong to. And all are equal in God's kingdom. All are spirit. All are equally free. All are equally free. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ. So, of course, as this world is going through these massive changes, there's insecurities, and what we do, many of us do, is you feel like, oh my gosh, I feel I need to attach myself to someone powerful, someone, you know, how else am I going to, I don't want to fall into slavery here, I don't, you know. And so we try to find a good aristocracy, you know. That's what I tried to do. I said, can't I find anyone who's a protector, a protectress, you know, powerful, but who's really good, who's spiritual, you know? And so, of course, there are those who claim that, oh yeah, but I'm the good queen, I'm the good princess. Don't worry, if you work for me, we'll make a really nice kingdom. Like that. And then you get pulled into that, and you find out they're just as wicked as any of them, because they view you as a slave. They view you as their property. They view that you're not supposed to talk back to them. They view that you're supposed to carry out their orders, their vision for what they want. That's your job. There's no freedom there. Nobody's a slave there. Nobody's a slave there. All you have to do is to make sure you practice. And practice is simple. He keeps saying, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is what Jesus has given us. He says, above all else, say this. So, you look at the for instance, look at Roman Catholicism. It's a compromise. It's been a compromise throughout history, actually. Trying to slip in some truth, but also making sure that they please the ET aristocracy and the hybrid aristocracy too. And it doesn't convey the clear teachings of Jesus at all. It does not convey it. But the teachings of Jesus are quite simple, actually. Just say this, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I relax my mind, I release my thoughts, and I let them go. Because my thoughts tell me absolutely nothing about what I am. Absolutely nothing about what I am. Thoughts are designed for results. What I am is not dependent on any results whatsoever. Never. This body, this world tells me absolutely nothing about what I am. Nothing whatsoever. This is Jesus' teachings also. The ET aristocracy tells us, oh no, this world is your home. This is God created this world, created you as a human, created you to function here, and to make this world beautiful for us. This is what they want you to believe, that you're a human being, and that you can't get to heaven until you die. You know, your freedom is after you die. In other words, after they get every last ounce of blood and sweat and tears and toil and slavery out of you. And throw you to the curb after you die. And they say, yeah, then you can be free. Yes, it's okay then. What utter nonsense. I'm free right now. Everyone is free right now. I'm already free. Now Jesus asks us to practice in this way, which the aristocracy doesn't like. And we say, well, the aristocracy is not around. Oh, yes, it is. The ideologies are very much around in the various societies and groups, etc., keeping all of this going. The bloodlines may not be quite what they used to be. They used to be very important, the bloodlines, right? They're planet was obsessed with bloodlines. Like, for me, from a human standpoint, I never gave a single thought to bloodlines whatsoever. It doesn't even register. Much of this ET teaching doesn't even register in me at all. It's like, nothing. I didn't feel the slightest interest whatsoever to any of that stuff. I'm not interested really in space travel, you know, colonization of space. None of that stuff, even the universe, doesn't even interest me at all. Why? Isn't that my home? I'm spirit. I'm free. I'm absolutely free. And I'm not a child. I'm not a result. I don't need any results to be what I am. Anyway, the bloodlines were like just, you know, incredibly, incredibly important. And no, Jesus did not produce any bloodlines. That's a lie from the ETs and the hybrid aristocracy. That's an absolute lie. They've been trying to get that in there, you know, to boost their own. That's one of the big lies they've told, to boost their own legitimacy to the world, is that Mary Magdalene and Jesus produced a family. It's all nonsense. Absolute nonsense. Jesus did not have the slightest attraction to bodies whatsoever. Jesus knew he was not a body. Zero attraction to bodies. No progeny, no offspring. There are no bloodlines of Jesus in this world. That is a vicious lie told by the aristocracy to legitimize themselves. They say, oh yeah, we're from the bloodline of Jesus. We have royal divine blood in us, you know, this sort of thing. You know, if they wanted his blood, yeah, we get his blood that will legitimize his people, worship us as divine, as gods, and they'll be willing slaves. See, they always want willing slaves here, is what they want. Willing slaves. But yeah, it's not so fun if you got slaves who want to are not willing, want to rebel, is it? You want real good, complacent, and willing slaves, and oftentimes they'll use this pretty princess figure, nice woman, the nice queen, who, you know, sweet talks all the slaves and says, you know, look, you're working for me, you know, so look how nice I am. And that's an attempt to get the slaves to be more willing to buy into this nonsense that they're bodies. When slaves start hearing, hey, I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit, as God created me, the teachings of Jesus. Wow, that's subversive, isn't it? The aristocracy saw the teachings of Jesus being extremely subversive. Jesus says bloodlines don't make any difference whatsoever. There's nothing to it whatsoever. You're not a body. You're spirit. Time and space, process and form doesn't exist, actually. It's an illusion. It's a delusion. It's a make-believe wish that of spirit. But wishing all of this, just wishing this were true, it's not true. It is not true. We're completely free. We're not never bound at all. Never dependent at all. We don't need any results whatsoever. Now, Jesus also says we need to drop our thoughts. Well, the way we can practice this as we're thinking, as we have a train of thought, just suddenly recognize it. Oh, I'm thinking. And then just drop it. Immediately just go, oh, I'm not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit as God created me. Just drop it. This is a practice I've been doing throughout the day. As I'm thinking, I start thinking something, whatever it is. I'm angry, I got a grievance. Just drop it. Don't follow it through at all. Don't follow through at all. Drop it right now. And you can even, in the midst of your human life, so to speak, drop that human life, so to speak, that belief system, like that. And you realize, well, I'm spirit. I'm not a body. I'm not a body at all. Only my thoughts are thinking that I'm a body. But I can drop those thoughts anytime, this right this instant. Of course, the aristocracy says, no, you can't do that. You gotta live full life. You gotta live full life as a slave. And then if you have been good servants of us, then you'll go to heaven. You see, is what they tell us. If you've made life comfortable for us and been honorable, served honorably, you know, as a human slave, then you get a ticket to heaven. utter nonsense. We're already not a body. We're already not a human. We're not already not a creature of time, space, process, and form. We're already completely free of all that because none of it exists. How can we not already be free of what doesn't exist? This is a question. Right? How can we not already be free of what doesn't exist? So when we're thinking, like, how do I get free? We're thinking about how do we get free from something that already doesn't exist. How intelligent is that? So just drop the thought. You know, I'm thinking this, thinking, whoops, I'm thinking, just drop it. I'm already free. I don't have to, my freedom doesn't require me to do any thinking at all. Thinking involves time. At least that's what we say, time. You know, it's like, well, okay, how do I get free? How do I get free of time? No, we're already inherently free of what doesn't exist. I am already free of what doesn't exist. Everyone is. Meaning doesn't exist, meaning has no self-existence. I mean, we're having fantasies, wishes. You know, you could say that exists as a form of a mirage, a fantasy. But it has no self-existence. It's completely dependent on our desire to keep these dreaming. But when we decide, oh, I don't want to dream anymore, poof, it's gone. Vanished without a trace. It has no self-existence whatsoever. So, like, oh, I'm dreaming, moments are bound together. Well, they're not. I can imagine and pretend they are, but when I stop pretending, I realize, oh, they're not. Never were. They never were. See, that's why I say vanished without a trace. We realize that it never was there in the first place. Like that person who sees a rope and thinks it's a snake, and then realize, oh, it's just a rope. What happened to the snake? It was never there. So where'd it go? How'd it vanish? No, it was just a hallucination. Misperceptions don't have any self-existence to them, really. No. Now, are humans waking up? Not really. Now, they think they are. There's a lot of humans think they're waking up. I don't see it. Just waking up is much simpler than what they're trying to do. What they're trying to do is they're trying to be equal to the ETs. They're trying to evolve and get this technology and be like the ETs. You know, monkey see, monkey do. They think they want to ape their superiors to the point where they become just as good as them. That's not enlightenment. That's not the gospel of Jesus at all. Jesus says, I'm not a body. I'm not this body. I'm not an ET body. I'm not any body whatsoever. I'm nobody. I'm no body at all. I am completely free. There's absolutely nothing that binds me whatsoever. I'm not bound by any result, any lack of result. I'm not bound by any need of needs to be completed or incomplete. Nothing binds me. I'm absolutely free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. We don't have any superiors, none whatsoever. So what do we need to evolve for? What do we need to wait? What do we need to do all this effort for? We don't. Just need to wake up. So humanity is going through this, they feel this huge vibrational shift and shifting consciousness, so they'll they feel that they're going to be able to now be the equals of ET, of all sorts of psychic abilities, and be able to, you know, understand working with energy more, and, you know, all the stuff they feel that they're going to be able to do. Say, wow, we're going to be like the gods now. We'll be gods now. Yeah. Well, the ETs weren't gods. See, they're not. They're just part of this dream of delusion. The spiritual teachers look at these powers of manipulating energy and they say, waste of time, forget about it. I told the story of that this meditator that had really been working on energy and all this stuff, but being able to walk across a river or something after meditating for like, I don't know how many, 3 months they sit in there meditating, and they finally were able to walk across the river. And Buddha said, why didn't you just pay the ferryman a penny and take the boat? How stupid, you know, how stupid. That's not the goal at all. So trying to, you know, ape the ETs and they're all their clever, you know, manipulation of energy and all this kind of stuff. That's the booby prize. Oh, learning to terraform Earth, learning to work with the Earth energies, learning, you know, crystals and all that. That's the booby prize. So, I don't see humanity as a whole waking up. Not at all. Because if that were so, there would be vast amounts who would be very modest, very calm, serious, doing what Jesus advises them to do, or their religious teachings, if in the pure, accurate form, which would, and Jesus says, I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. And as Jesus tells us, all is God. All is God. All is, already is God. God doesn't require us to do all his sacrifices and worshiping and praying. And God advises us to wake up and realize what we are. That's all. What we are is an extension of God. So to not recognize what we are is, you know, like spitting on God, basically. Denying God. And this God is not angry because God gave us perfect freedom. We can even spit on what we are. But all we have to do is realize what we truly are. And that is not ETs at all. No. It's spirit. Which is, you know, completely formless, pure, like a sun radiating bliss and joy, totally invulnerable. We can't even conceive of it, really. We just have to experience it. So the world will be doing this. And one of the great evils of the aristocracy and mimicking ETs and hybrid, all this has happened, is advertising and marketing and using human figures in marketing and glamorizing the human body. As I pointed out, why this became so an obsession, especially among women, is it's still an obsession in this world. That obsession is way worse than it used to be. Feminism, a large part, is responsible for that, in that they basically said, hey, women should be able to do whatever they want to do, no man can tell them differently, meaning no human male has any right to curtail the advancement, or they call it the liberation of women, which really means they want to get in bed with ETs. That's exactly what it means. And human males were those who were saying, no, we don't want you to do that. It corrupts all of society, it corrupts us, it brings us all down. A lot of the religions and restrictions in human society says stay away from the ETs. That's a sin. It's evil. Stay away from them. Don't try to curry favor with them. It's very important. And what radical feminism, radical feminism came along, and they basically said to human males, hey, you know, shut up. You're trying to oppress us. You're trying to keep us down. You're trying to hold our potential, keep us from reaching our potential. What their potential, what they want to reach, is, again, to get in bed with ETs, which many, many of them have already, actually. Throughout the 80s and the 90s, there were millions of reports of human women having relations with reptilian extraterrestrials, actually. And they think this is their path to greatness, to satisfy their vanity, you know. And so any male, human male, that stood against this was an anathema, and has now become a stereotyped anathema. As an evil, wicked person who dares stand in the way of the great progress, you know, of women too. Now, that's the progress that they're aiming for. That's just why you see them now frantically working on their bodies, trying to make their bodies as attractive as possible, you know, super into fashion trending and all, and everything that glamorizing themselves as much as possible, because they hope to hook a ET mate, actually, and that will bring them into the aristocracy. They feel they'll be superior. And they don't feel that human males really have anything to offer them at all. Any of that. So, the Christians and those who follow these teachings of truth, of what's really the real truth, that we are not bodies at all, we're spirit. Often they were not from the aristocracy. They were a different class of people. They were more humans, not so corrupted by the court aristocratic court system. And they had suffered greatly from servitude, and they considered these teachings. They say, hey, let's pay attention to this. This is very interesting. You mean we're not really humans? We're not really bodies? We're not really slaves? Well, yeah, that's right. We're spirit. We're not a body. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. We're spirit imagining all this. Now, it gets a little deeper than this, for sure. So, this is a big movement among the humans of the world, various religions, and the aristocracy said, whoa, let's wipe them out. So, like, of course, in Rome, Christians were severely persecuted throughout much of the Roman Empire. they were deemed an anathema. Absolutely. They had to live underground in the catacombs to escape death, escape crucifixion. Finally, one of these aristocratic warlords had a dream where he saw a cross and, Constantine. And decided to fly the Christian banner or cross, banner of a cross, and won the battle. And then he said, hey, I think this god is more powerful than the other god, so I'm going to change the official god of the Roman Empire to the Christian god. Because I won the battle, you know? So then it became in vogue. But what happened was the aristocracy twisted Christianity to fit into their beliefs. So the people would still view the old god as the real god. So it got very, very confused and twisted, as throughout the ages. It's interesting to note that the Anunnaki, the reptilian ETs, their symbol is a Roman cross, actually. There are statues of them wearing Roman crosses from 6,000 years ago, along with wristwatches and flying machines and all this. So the aristocracy would just actually use this symbol. I mean, the actual, one of the most potent symbols of Christianity is the fish, is this fish symbol, you know. But it's become, through the ages, it's become this, you know, cross symbol, which is actually the symbol of Anunnaki. And you could say that that's worshiping the reptilian ETs as God. They come from a place, supposedly, Nibiru, which is, it's in a star system area that forms the sign of a cross. That may be why they wear the symbol of a cross that's in the sky. It looks like this Christian cross, actually. So you wonder why Jesus shows up here in the 1960s with A Course in Miracles, and then later with Dr. Brent Haskell with The Journey Beyond Words. You wonder why this teaching doesn't fit with historical Christianity, because historical Christianity has been corrupted by the Anunnaki ET hybrid aristocracy. It's been very corrupted to just basically fit in with what, you know, business as usual. They don't want you realizing you're not a body at all. This is a dream. They want you, they believe that they belong to you, that you belong to them as property, as slaves. So you can't have your, imagine if your car one morning decide, hey, you know what? I know I'm not a car at all. I'm actually spirit. I'm free. I don't have to be a car anymore. Wow. I can go anywhere I want to go. Whoops. Oh, no, car. You're just a car. No. Here, I got a religion for you that'll teach you you're just a car. So, of course, they don't want the people of the world knowing that they're free, that we're free. Not free humans, we're free spirit. We're absolutely free. Now, last night, I started sort of half dreaming, and I decided, hey, I'm going to start flying. And so my spirit just started moving through the air like this, flying. And suddenly I said, whoa, I can't do that. Well, you know, I got to get back to my body, right? I'm a body, I can't fly. I said, no, wait a minute here. What do you mean? I'm not a body. Not a body at all. Spirit can be everywhere at once, is already everywhere at once. But there's no limit to where spirit can be experiencing at all. Spirit is not bound by the body in the slightest bit. But if you're a slaveholder and you have all these bodies, you know, planting flowers for you 24 hours a day, which is, I mean, these ancient places like Babylon, I mean, Babylon, the Hanging Gardens of Babylon, I mean, these ancient cities were sumptuous. The gardening was sumptuous, and they called it these paradises, these enclosed courtyards, the courtyards of these great rulers. The amount of gardening is extraordinary. I mean, in India, they still have some of the Mughal gardens there, and you're just like, wow. But in ancient times, even more so. Worked by slaves, human slaves. They had finery, the aristocracy had sumptuous lives. And of course, you get the humans peeking over the wall and saying, wow. Now, a man could not really marry into a female reptilian like that. It didn't work that way. So it was the women who had the opportunity. So they became very conniving. And of course, men have been complaining about that all throughout the ages, of this sort of attitude, like, hey, you know, don't like it. again, from men, but they're simple dress, modest women, simple dressed. Don't put on airs. Stop trying to impress the aristocracy, you know, because they look at you like we look at cattle. We don't need to anyway. Now, how do you skip camp, you know, get out of there, camp of the aristocracy, and go over to the camp of Jesus, for instance, camp of truth? Well, we may think, wow, we don't want to leave a high position serving the aristocracy and go to Jesus' camp because it seems so impoverished and doesn't seem anything there. It seems so difficult. I'd be really lowly and stuff like that. Now, this is not true. It's very simple. All you have to do is say, I'm not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. All you need to work toward is relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. Relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. Jesus' way is very simple and merciful, compassionate, and easy, actually. You don't have to put on airs to please Jesus. You don't have to be conniving to please Jesus. All you have to do is practice. That's it. All that Jesus asks us is to practice. And this includes other religious teachers throughout history. But they said, hey, all you got to do is just practice. You don't have to be some seductress or some slave working harder. Just practice these simple exercises and awaken yourself from this dream. Because that's what it is. It's a dream, ultimately, of trying to limit a loss that doesn't exist. Is trying to learn to limit what doesn't exist, which time doesn't exist, actually. We're trying to learn to limit time, we're trying to learn to limit space, trying to limit death, trying to limit sickness. But none of these things actually are self-existent at all. We first imagine they are, and then say, oh my gosh, I gotta limit this, how terrible. You know, Then we think, well, we're serving spirit, we're protecting spirit, we're learning how to limit this terrible plague that would strike spirit if not for our great efforts to protect spirit. So we feel like we're protecting ourselves from something, but what we're protecting ourselves from doesn't exist. So it's complete folly, whimsical folly is what we're really engaged with. And we can actually recognize this and see it and wake up and realize, wow, I really am spirit. I'm not a body at all. I don't need any thoughts. I'm complete. I don't need any results at all. Now, this is totally counter to what the ET aristocracy has conditioned us to believe, which is that we're all about getting results for them, basically. You know, be fruitful, multiply the earth, you know, work hard, work on this, make the world a better place. That's for their estates, for their pleasure, for their rule. You know, get rid of the wild animals so they can, my lady can have her ride through her estates without being attacked by lions or something like that. Put on shows in the Colosseum, so the aristocratic ladies, which are mostly, a lot of them were the aristocratic ladies, the hybrids, those who were part of this aristocracy, those are the ones who would go to the Colosseum and watch humans tear themselves to pieces in battles, battle wild animals and be devoured, and they thought this was like wonderful entertainment. Oh, it's wonderful entertainment. This is all true. Thinking how superior they were to humans, that they could watch humans be torn to pieces. There's nothing more insecure and vicious than one of these hybrid aristocracy. Of course, a lot of the women who were very vicious throughout history, very cold-hearted, vicious towards humans. John the Baptist, you know, was Salome, whatever it is, the king said, I'll give you anything you want. The reptilian king, like, had reptilian blood, and the seductress, he was interested in her. They're dancing, right? And she was like super good at the reptilians like dancing. You know, they like flashy clothes, they like, you know, scantily clad women with makeup and all this seductive dancing. They really like that. Human men don't spit on that, actually. It's disgusting. And so she was into Herod, you know, getting, and he was interested in her because of her dancing. And John the Baptist was telling how vicious, how wicked she was, and how wicked these women were who were trying to curry favor with the ETs. And he said, I'll give you anything you want. And she said, I want the head of John the Baptist. And he says, whoa, 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 no, 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 that's not politically correct. That's going to cause a problem in my kingdom because he has a great following. And she says, hey, you're going to go back on your word? He says, oh, you know, they couldn't do that. There's propriety within ET civilization. They have all sorts of rules and regulations and things they can and can't do. You know, it's very structured. And he basically said, well, I can't go back on my word. I'd lose face or something. That'd be bad. So, you see? who was responsible for John? Salome was responsible for it, actually. Because she was infuriated that John the Baptist was pointing out, hey, you're just a commoner. What are you trying to prove here? Come on. You're corrupting the women of the area. You know, he was criticizing, and she was absolutely furious because she was so ambitious. She wanted to gain this luxury, live in luxury, in the lap of luxury. So that's why. This is real human. This is real history. I mean, don't even call it human history. This is just history on this planet. History on this planet is not something that's taught in school. Thank God there are a lot of people who are getting tuned into it now. I've been trying to tell this my whole life, tell people this. I read the history in school. I said, this is nonsense. This is nothing but lies. Nothing but lies. Convenient lies that the aristocracy has made certain that we listen to. Keep in mind that the school system that spread throughout the world started in Prussia. And it was the Prussian king who was being undermined by the princes of that area. The Prussian king said, I need to make sure that the princes don't revolt against me, the people don't revolt against me, so instituted mandatory schooling for all children. And the curriculum was designed for them to worship the king as divine, basically, and to feel ultimate loyalty to the king, okay, to the aristocracy. So this Prussian school system is actually spread throughout the whole planet. And this is what this whole planet has been raised on, is to believe, unquestioning belief in what the aristocracy, what the tells us we're supposed to believe. And so, of course, they try to cover up all information about what's really taking place in this world, because then we say, hey, wait a minute. You know, this is, you know, I think I'm going to go over to Jesus, actually, because he offers me real freedom from this slavery. So, the truth has been buried. They've taken every effort to bury it. Of course, they're not a body either. They're spirit, exactly as God created. We're all spirit. All this nonsense is just a dream. So, coming over to the camp of freedom. Jesus is just offering us freedom from a dream of enslavement, really. The idea that somehow we're supposed to make this world a beautiful paradise and live here with bodies and everybody happy is ridiculous. No one who realizes that they're actually spirit is interested in being a body. That's completely absurd. I know there's a lot of New Age movements that can talk a really good game. And they do talk a very good game. But their game is all about, you know, Mother Earth improving, learning to live in harmony with nature and have healthy bodies here. And come on, who are they trying to, who are they kidding? Who are they kidding? I mean, the rhetoric's very smooth and advanced, and they have a lot of truth peppered in there, okay? But it's like a lure to hook a fish. I am not a body. How can that not get through there? You know, that's very simple. I am not a body, period. I have never been a body. I can never be a body. I am as God created me. I am not a body. I am free, absolutely free. Write this right now. Always have been absolutely free to be a universe, to be multiverses, to be not universe at all, be beyond anything we can imagine. I am completely free, freer than the freest breeze possible. Right now, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is the truth. This is the gospel of Jesus. It's a gospel of freedom. This is the real gospel of Jesus. This is the real good news. We don't have to keep on buying into this nonsense that we're bodies and we're supposed to, our work here is supposed to rake up the leaves and plant flowers and make this world nice for the higher ups, you know, really. That's lunacy. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And the freedom that Jesus says, the freedom that we are is completely incomprehensible to our concepts and imagining and thoughts and thinking. Totally incomprehensible. It's so glorious and so wonderful. There is no way we can even imagine it. So, the notion, and Jesus says we're not, he sees us not as bodies at all, but as these glowing, scintillating, radiating, golden light, shimmering, beautiful, radiating forever, light extending forever. You know, he sees himself the same way. He doesn't see himself as a body at all. So, there's been this uneasy deal-making between religions and aristocracy throughout history, where the aristocracy has gotten their way, and they manage to say, well, you wanted to survive here, we'll let you stay here, but you need to teach, you know, make sure the people worship us, you know, as divine ruler. Most people out of history thought the aristocracy was divine, put here by God, put here by the ETs. Not by God. God doesn't create bodies. God has nothing to do with bodies. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. God created me as completely formless idea, spirit. I am an idea in the mind of God. That's what I am. So, aristocracy is not divine, not any less divine than we are. There's only one divinity, which is we all are it. We all are one family, actually, of spirit. We don't belong to, and they're sworn. I mean, this is something that has been going on for quite some time now. And the ratio of females to males is often 8 to 2. Sometimes 9 to 1, 8 to 2, 7 to 3. But always, way more women are involved with these spiritual teachers than men. Because men are told they don't matter anymore anyway. And this is the new, you know, this is the new age, and it's the women are going to have the power, meaning they're going to be the consorts of the powerful here. That's what they're all struggling for. And you see in these spiritual groups, you have women desperately trying to be the consorts of the spiritual teacher, you know, be the favorites, instead of actually practicing their own salvation. They're more interested in trying to catch the eye of the spiritual teacher. And of course, then these spiritual teachers, many of them get involved in relationships with the women. Absolutely, this is what the women are after. And they think, hey, if I can please the spiritual teacher, I can please someone better than them. I can please the ETs, the divinity, gods, the gods. I can please the gods. You know, they understand that the ETs are not gods. They're not divinity any more so than the fact that all is divine, equally divine. So yeah, he comes out. Just recently, I read something about some supposedly very respected spiritual teacher. Oh wow, I'm not gonna say who. And never heard a bad word about him. And then someone said, oh, I actually was good friends with him for a long time and knew him most of his life. And, you know, it's amazing. I hear stuff that people are saying. He was actually made a habit of getting involved with romantic relationships with the women that came to see him, which is what the women were after anyway. He said, okay, why not? And then the other spiritual teachers that actually are even more well-known, I won't say who they are, who had a harem of women, tremendous, constantly relationships, romantic relationships with all these women. Because he said, hey, this is actually what they're here for, so I might as well enjoy, you know. And then, of course, claiming that he was some, you know, great, awesome, all-powerful God and such like that, because that's what they wanted. He said, wow, I want to be the consort of this. They weren't there for enlightenment. And you find out many, many of these male teachers got pulled down to that. Some said, what the heck, you know, or they say, yeah, I'll just work this angle. And some didn't want to, but ultimately the pressure on them pulled them down. And, you know, but yeah, you find out the real story behind it. And you find out that many of these revered spiritual teachers were involved with many, many, many women. All sorts, all ages, mostly young, you know, the ones who are very aggressive, very, very, use their youth to seduce them, absolutely. It's a madhouse, this planet, isn't it? It's really a madhouse. The Christian tradition was very careful. They put men and women separate, men in hermitage, women in nunneries. Mother Superior, you know, ran the thing, and she reported to the overall structure of authority in the church. There is no chance for those women. You want to go the spiritual path. You're in a nunnery. You're not trying to seduce the bishops or trying to, you know. No, absolutely not. You're covering yourself up. You are modest in all times and places. When you go outside, if you are covered up, you know, absolutely. This helps the whole situation, very much so. But that's gone with the wind here, gone with the wind for the most part. Islam is still trying to keep it, but it's under severe attack. Their social customs are under severe attack. that they want women to stop covering up publicly, and they want to give them freedom to be as scantily clad as possible. This is the pressure that Islam is under. Islam is under tremendous global pressure to give up their customs, a lot of which are very wise customs in many ways. So see, they understand the problem right here. They understand the problem of the EDs and their attempt to corrupt humanity and enslave them and keep them enslaved and all this kind of stuff. And they understand the how vanity of women can get out of control, and that has to be kept very much under control. That's the problem of this planet. So there's this vicious pressure to basically, you know, let all women run around half naked and nobody say a word about it. You know, and this whole thing about dogs too, and now it's just incredible how dogs have encroached upon in markets everywhere. Nobody says a word. I want to say, hey, I love dogs, but there's some places that I don't want to see dogs, okay? There's this golden hardware store today. There's a dog in there just going on sniffing everybody. And the lady's just like, oh yeah, I can do whatever I want to do. Nobody can tell me I can bring my dog anywhere I want to bring. I can dress any way I want to dress. I can do anything I want to, you know. You've come a long way, baby. You know, you can do whatever you want to do, meaning you can pursue extraterrestrials. That's what it really means. You can show how animalistic you are. You can stir up their, you know, primal, reptilian primal urges, you know. That's what they're after. And of course, they also are pretend. One thing that stirs up the reptilian lust is to pretend you're an ingenue, you know. I'm a spiritual ingenue. I'm this innocent human, you know, and they layer that on top of everything, and it's a conquest for the reptilians. It's a conquest, you know. It's like, wow, the chase, you know, the conquest. I can bring this one down into depravity, you know. It's so some of the even slicker ones, the real slick one more place. So some of the real slicker ones, they go to these spiritual teachers, trying to develop a patina of sanctity, you know, because the reptilians love to ravish, you know, destroy sanctity in humans. That's a sport for them. And so they want to put on the pretend. So they'll have this inner seductiveness there, and the reptilians are saying, ha, huh, there's something there, you know, and then they'll have this sanctity, like, oh yes, I'm so spiritual and holy, and no, I'm not interested in you, you know, and all this, and I can't be corrupted, you know. Yes, my Lord, but I, you know, I'm pure. I can't be corrupted, you know. And the reptilians say, oh, wow, okay, this is a challenge for me. You know, I want to show that I'm great, you know, that I'm greater than God. I can, and so you see, they're very clever that way too. So they don't really go into truly trying to wake up from the dream. They just want to figure out how to pretend to be all pure and sanctified, see, and so they go to these teachers and try to learn the lingo and all this kind of stuff. You know, they, oh yeah, I'm, you know, and that excites the reptilian hybrids and the stuff, right? Yeah, it is absolutely this way, and it is absolutely every bit as horrible as I'm depicting it. And men are just like, hey, you know, for me, it's like, if I never see this world again, it'll be too soon, actually. If I never see women again, it'll be too soon, as far as I'm tired of trying to, you know, advise them, they don't pay any attention anyway, and they just hate you for it anyway, you know, and I got better things to do, you know. I'm spirit, I'm free, I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm spirit, I'm still a sky. Still exactly as God created me. I got better things to do than to keep trying to say, hey, you know, come on, you know. Wow. Tired of that. Yeah, of course, the thing is that human, the experience, the dream experience we've had as being like a human male. We feel compassionate toward human females, and we want the best for them. So it's very terrible to see what they've done, where their direction they're going, and it's just like a tragedy. It's a catastrophe. I don't want to feel that any longer. I want to be free of all thoughts. I want to have only good thoughts, or not even good thoughts. I want to be in the enlightened condition, like a Ramana Maharshi. And we can. We absolutely can. But the problem is the overall zeitgeist of the world, especially coming from the women who are really in charge of social ideology in the world now. And not that they've never not been largely in charge, but during religious times they had to toe the line some degree. What place? But right now the zeitgeist is that anyone who is like Ramana Maharshi or something like that, they're trying to, you know, undermine progress or undermine, you know, this is, that's old fashioned. That's not right. It's not right anymore. You're not supporting us in what we're trying to do here. You're not supporting us in trying to, you know, it's like men have basically worked themselves to death trying to support women's ambition to hook some ET. You know, that's basically what men do now in this world. Well, we spend our life, you know, we're working the worst type of jobs possible, whatever, working ourselves to death just so we can glamorize the women of our family, our, you know, wife, children, grandchildren, nieces, and, you know, whatever. Provide them the means to be all glamorized up so maybe they can attract the aristocracy, you know, the ET, the hybrids. This is our role. This is the role they tell us is fulfilling for us, that because we're now helping them, finally we're learning how to help them and to be supportive of them, you know. This is just such utter rubbish, such sickening nonsense, you know. Who in the world, what man would be proud that one of their family hooked an ED, you know? That's not something to be proud of. That's a disgrace. Something that's absolutely disgraceful. So I would say the women of the world are behaving in an extremely disgraceful way. Many of them, not all, of course. And I encourage those who are not behaving in such a disgraceful way to listen to Jesus and practice what he says. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. And I've already succeeded. I've already succeeded in relaxing my mind. I've already succeeded in releasing my thoughts. I've already succeeded in letting them go. I've already succeeded, I'm already enlightened. Practice this, I'm already enlightened. And you won't be interested in those reptilian ETs. You'll set vanity aside, and you say that's absolute nonsense. I want the real prize, you know, which is freedom, absolute freedom. Very great, my voice held up, but it was quite a struggle. That's it.